Philippine shares begin the new trading week in the green, the main index closing above the 7,100 level after gaining over 1%. Value turnover was at 3.9 billion pesos. William Matthew Cabangon, President of AAA Securities and Equities, joins us now on the Business Roadshow to assess today's trade. Hi, Will. Glad you could join us this afternoon.
Hi, Stanley. Thanks for having me back on the show. It's my pleasure.
All right, 7,100 with tepid volume. Are you seeing strong support now forming at 7K? Now, or are you still considering this level very vulnerable?
You know, there's a lot of celebration going on now. This is the highest level our index has been in a while. But I would caution investors to celebrating a bit too early. I wouldn't call 7,000 a sort of rock bottom resist support at this point, because we have very big economic events coming up this week. In my view, probably the biggest economic event of the year. So a lot of things can happen, and you know, I wouldn't be too complacent about the market's potential downside from here.
Okay, but when you look at our stocks though, Will, are most of them oversold now at this point? And what perhaps are your calculations for a correction, be it a normal correction or a severe one?
Oversold is the Philippine Stock Exchange's middle name. You know, there's so many cheap stocks, and I've been advocating for, you know, all year that, you know, that investors should be buying these cheap names with hopes to harvest those gains in a time like today or hopefully in the near future. When looking at potential downside from here, you know, quite frankly, I think it's muted. I don't think that there's very much that can go wrong, at least towards the end of the year. So I would still give the same advice to investors to pick up quality, cheap names, because even after today's rally, they're still very abundant.
Yes, quality, cheap names. That is the advice, but really the reality is investors are just focusing on just a couple of names, the stable ones, those that have been performing actively in the past, few trades maybe. What's making them stay away from those names that you've said that are already affordable and have sizable potential?
So I think when investors are assessing what stocks to buy, cheap is obviously, you know, one leg of a two-legged animal. The other leg has to be growth.
Okay.
So, you know, I think a lot of companies right now, they are cheap, but they aren't presenting the kind of growth opportunities that are really opening investors' eyes. And, you know, take no look further than the real estate industry. I think the property industry is extremely cheap, but the headwinds there kind of make their growth outlook not very attractive. So you really need both things, both value and growth, to align when you're assessing what stock to buy.
Okay, now Will, you said that this week is going to be a big week. In fact, very recently, we haven't had anything like this in the past, since 2020 at least. For many markets, they're now anticipating the Fed rate cutting happening. Some say that with the U.S. economy flirting with recession, it should be no less than 50 basis points this week. Do you see any reason now for the Federal Reserve to be less aggressive in its rate cutting?
So I'm no central bank insider, certainly not a U.S. central bank insider. But in my view, I don't see them cutting 50 basis points. A normal cut is about 25 basis points. And the reason why I don't see them cutting by 50 is that a large 50 basis point cut is basically a signal to everyone that there is a big problem, that they're in an emergency, and that they need to make up for lost time. That would be quite embarrassing for the Federal Reserve. After all, you know, they've spent the better part of the last 2 or 3 years fighting runaway inflation. Yeah. And now they're gonna be signaling that, a recession is inevitable and we need to cut rates aggressively. I just don't see that happening. In my view, it's 25 basis points.
Okay, so it's 25 basis points. I'm just wondering now if the Fed cut, the upcoming rate cut this week, is also a market-moving event for the Philippine Stock Exchange. I know it is for a lot of markets outside.
Absolutely. You know, this is a globally interlinked market. this will be market moving. Obviously, whether it's 25 or 50, but this being the first rate cut in a rate cycle, I think people will be tuning in very intently to the press conference and see, you know, because we don't really know yet what the terminal rate is, right? Like, we now know that the rates have hit their peak. Where's the low going to be? We have no clarity on that yet, and I suspect that to be the biggest talking point for the next 12 months.
Okay.
So I think, you know, everyone's going to be watching that intently, and that in turn will give some clues as to what the BSP will do. You know, all of these things are sort of interrelated anyway.
Okay, now Will, you know, another thing to watch out for, the peso expected to trade sideways. It is, in fact, trading sideways now, or at least before the Fed starts easing its rates. What possibilities do you see now for local currency after cut happens? Are there signs of a weakening dollar now with a policy change?
Yeah, I'm very much on team weakening dollar from here on. US rates coming down should make the dollar less attractive, and we should see flows come back into Philippine peso. So, you know, I think the worst is over as far as
currency.
Peso depreciation is concerned. So that is going to be a big tailwind for our economy.
Okay, and of course, for our last policy decision for the part of the Banco Central ng Pilipinas happening this November, inflation, the numbers would play a big part in it. How are you seeing that now? Some see a trend of further easing from August to September, even October, and then a slight uptick of inflation in the Philippines in November. What are you pricing in?
So I'm trying not to get lost, you know, I'm not trying to lose the forest for the trees here. The fact of the matter is the BSP has started their rate cutting cycle, and I think, you know, the Fed is obviously about to start their rate cutting cycle. So I unless there is some sort of freak reading in inflation where it's wildly sort of above expectations, I don't see material changes in the outlook for interest rates. And now I leave the projections of interest rates to the economists. That's not my game. But ultimately, in trying to assess where asset prices are headed, I think from here, probabilities being weighted, I think they're going higher.
All right. Lastly, Will, and back to the markets now. What pricing conditions of certain stocks must investors avoid this week and maybe in the near term? And for those looking for leads, which stocks do you still find attractive?
So as far as, you know, industries or sectors that I'm not so bullish on, I've mentioned it earlier, I'm not that bullish on property stocks in general. The supply overhang is just too large. And I know that interest rates are coming down and that should help the industry. But I think, you know, the boom times of the last 10 years have kind of front run a lot of growth. So I would generally try to avoid those names. As far as industries that I really like gaming right now. I think the names in that category, and there aren't very many in our market, I think they look extremely attractive. Both from a valuation standpoint and a growth standpoint, the two legs that I mentioned earlier. And finally, if you're looking at, you know, global markets in general, people might notice that gold prices have basically gone vertical. I think it's a nice opportunity for people to get exposure to some mining names who have gold exposure. I think that would be sort of an essential part of many people's portfolios. So, you know, that's my two cents to the viewers that I hope will help out with their portfolios.
All right, William Matthew Cabauan, president of AAA Equities. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Have a profitable trading week ahead.
Thanks very much.